Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 20th May 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles selected for today's analysis from the Chennai, Delhi, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions of the newspaper. Now the link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the news articles are provided in the description box. For the benefit of mobile phone viewers, the timestamping of the news articles are also provided in the comment section. Now let us move on to the first news article. Now, this article is an editorial article written by former National Security Advisor of India. The article is about assessment of Islamic State 2.0. The term, you know, taking stock means assessment or review or relook. So in our context, it means assessment of a particular organization, that is Islamic State. Now, this article will be relevant in your prelims preparation under current events of national and international importance. And in mains under GS paper 3, in the role of external state and non-state actors in creating challenges to internal security and challenges to internal security through communication networks, role of media and social networking sites in internal security challenges and generally security challenges to India. The author has written the article to take caution of the recent coordinated large-scale simultaneous attacks on multiple targets that happened in Sri Lanka on April 21 this year, on targets such as three churches and three hotels. The Islamic State of Iraq and Syria, and shortly also called as ISIS or the Islamic State, has claimed responsibility for carrying out these attacks in Sri Lanka. The author observes that IS has carried out terrorist attacks in three countries in almost similar fashion. One is the IS attack on three churches in Surabaya in Indonesia in May 2018, and the other an attack in a church in Jolo in Philippines in January 2019, and the thirdly this recent attack carried out in Sri Lanka. With the terror attack in Sri Lanka, the author is saying that the present-day South Asia is in a virtual cauldron of radical Islamic extremist activity, as radical Islamist extremism is present in Afghanistan, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Maldives, India and Sri Lanka. Although India may prefer to believe that they are shielded from such tendencies, such radical Islamic tendencies, which is wrong according to the author, and such a belief from the Indian side needs a review or a relook, says the author. In the recent years and with these terrorist attacks, the Islamic extremists have transformed a moderate Islamic landscape of Sri Lanka into a more radicalized Islamic landscape. Now, this transformation was done by swaying hundreds of impressionable youth, or you know, the youth who can be easily influenced into a radical and terror agenda. The advent of the Islamic State occurred at the beginning of the second decade of 21st century with a potent mixture of teachings from Sayyid Qutb of Egypt, Abdullah Azam of Palestine and Jalaluddin Haqqani of Afghanistan. Inspired by their extreme ideologies, a new breed of terrorists joined this Islamic State, and the leader of Islamic State declared a new caliphate in the year 2014 that included the territories of Iraq, Syria, and for the Muslims in the world. But gradually, the Islamic State has lost its territories that it once held in 2014 and 15. And by March 2019, its area of occupancy was reduced to a greater extent. Now, see the image, how much the territories they once had and how much they have now. It is to take this revenge, and the revenge for the loss of one of their territories that happened this year, the IS has attacked Sri Lanka, as claimed by them. Now, here in this article, the author gives the version 2.0 to the present ISIS, that is, after their dismantling of areas occupied in Iraq and Syria. It was thought by some experts that once this Islamic State is dismantled, you know, territorially, it may not become a threat with severity later. But though the caliphate is now not in existence, the concept of caliphate proclaimed is still a core idea of Islamic State.
And the new version, that is Islamic State 2.0, retains the ability to convert many young people over the internet and social media. See, earlier it was lone wolf attacks. Now it has moved from lone wolf attacks to coordinated, large-scale, simultaneous attacks on multiple targets. A lone wolf attack or a lone wolf terrorist, is a person who acts alone rather than as a part of larger organization, in our case, Islamic State. And a lone wolf attack is an attack carried out by a lone wolf terrorist. Now, territorial flexibility of Islamic State is being replaced with strategic flexibility. That is, earlier Islamic State had territory in control. Now they have only the strategy in control. So in this backdrop, the author suggests few important things India has to do to insulate itself from such attacks on its land in the future. India has to recognize the reality with respect to Islamic State 2.0 and the threats and danger that this organization exhibit are real. This acceptance has to be there. And India should not feel that it is shielded from such radical extremist tendencies. It is not so. And the idea that it is shielded from such tendencies needed a review or relook is the theme given by the author. See, the links between IS groups in Sri Lanka and India is also a cause of concern. And India should conduct detailed investigation in all the cases associated with Islamic extremism and radical tendencies that are in the hands of National Investigation Agency. The investigations will disclose further links, and by the investigations, the future plans or other plans of the terrorist organizations can be hunted down. Now, then see, the Indians who went to Syria to join IS have now returned and are still returning. Now, they could be having the feeling of revenge because they went there and their efforts for IS or the Islamic State has failed. And now they are here and they could take revenge. It could be a lone wolf attack or it could be a coordinated large-scale attack. And this has to be tackled accordingly at the right time. The Islamic State 2.0 will also nurture the young Muslim youth through internet, not only youth, even children, through internet and social media, preferably by a band of highly radical preachers of Islamic State. Now, children and youth have the possibility to turn radical when they watch such content online when they are alone or when they are without proper guidance, parental guidance or guidance of the teacher. Now, there has to be enough mechanisms to tackle this menace to curb both lone wolf attacks and coordinated attacks in Indian soil. With this, we come to the end of this editorial discussion. The displayed practice mains question will be discussed in the last session in this video. With this, now let us move on to the analysis of next news article. Now let's see two articles that are on same lines and are pertaining to the state of Odisha. The article "Odisha plans to restore coastal green cover" appears on page 9 of Delhi edition, 7 in Bengaluru, Chennai and Thiruvananthapuram editions. The article "Experts urge administration to plant trees which can withstand cyclones" appears on page number 5 in Delhi edition only. Now, these articles will be relevant in prelims under general issues on environmental ecology, biodiversity and in general science, and in mains under GS paper 3 in disaster management. Now, the news is that a group of botanists have urged the Bhubaneswar city administration to undertake plantation of native species that can withstand strong cyclonic winds in future. Native species are those species that naturally occur in a region or ecosystem without direct or indirect human actions. Now, this is because of the recent devastating cyclone Fani that hit the state of Odisha. Due to the cyclone, almost 99% of the trees in the state had suffered damage. We all know that the state of Odisha is known for vast biodiversity. But previously, before the cyclone, there were around 1,677 trees having a girth or a diameter or circumference of around 10 centimeter were recorded along different road stretches in various localities in the state. Now, after the cyclone Fani, the assessment was carried out by the team. Now, at that time, it was found that 99% of the recorded trees were either uprooted or snapped or broken. See, around 6% of the trees were uprooted, 5% suffered complete damage, the remaining were, you know, snapped or broken or faced some kind of damage. 57% of the trees were partially damaged. And it is also found that some native species of trees withstood the cyclone. And this was observed during the cyclone. And some of the species were Pongamia pinnata, which is locally called as Karanja, and also Alstonia scholaris, locally called as Chattiana. These trees suffered minimal damage and will be back to their original shape after the summer monsoon. So the botanist team has suggested the state government to plant that native trees that will withstand high wind speed, because Odisha is prone to multiple natural hazards, particularly cyclones. See, even though the coastline of Odisha represents roughly 17% of the east coast of India, nearly 35% of cyclonic and severe cyclonic storms with associated furious and hurricane winds attack the coastal stretch of Odisha. See, the native species are, you know, Karanja, Chattiana, Neem, Jamun tree, which is called as Naval Palam in Tamil, and etc. See, these trees withstood high wind speed and they lost only 50% of their branches. So these species should get priority when plantation will be undertaken in future, you know, with respect to handling the cyclones or disaster preparedness. Now, the next news article talks about the Odisha government's new scheme, which aims at planting over 1.3 crore saplings in the state. Now, this is a 5-year scheme to restore the green cover lost due to cyclone Fani in the coastal region. The program or scheme is named as, you know, 5-year action plan on revival of coastal shelter belt and afforestation program. And it will be a urban tree plantation program. So under this plan, the government would undertake an afforestation program on around 8,000 hectares over a 5-year period. In this urban tree plantation program, around 5 lakh saplings would be planted in 5 years. Also about 30,000 uprooted trees would be replanted and restored in suitable places. The government also aims to plant fruit-bearing plants in around 12,000 hectares. Now, this is to help to revive the livelihood of many cyclone-affected people. And the plan suggests planting different varieties of cyclone-resistant trees, such as Neem, Karanja or Pongami pinnata, Bala, Jamun, Korila, Chattiana, Kaira, Arjun, Mahoni, Ashok, Harida, Bahada, Sishu, Kadachamba, and Dimiri. Now, these are some of the varieties of cyclone resistant trees. Now, in this context, let us see about Karanja or Pongamia pinnata, which is important from our examination point of view. It is called as Karanj in Hindi and Pungamaram in Tamil. See, Pongamia pinnata is native to humid and subtropic environments. And note that subtropical environment can occur even in tropical places at some locations, specific locations. It talks about environments. And it is commonly found along waterways or seashores with its roots in fresh or salt water. Now, it's highly tolerant of saline conditions and alkalinity, and it occurs naturally along the edges of mangrove forests. And it is also one speciality that it is a shade bearer. When we mean shade bearer, it means it can grow under the shade of other trees. Most important fact of Pongamia pinnata or this Karanja is that it is also drought resistant, and it adapts well to adverse climatic conditions and soil moisture conditions. See the map, it shows countries where the species has been planted. native range of the trees is found in Bangladesh, India, Myanmar, Nepal, and Thailand. An exotic range can be identified as grid line pattern in this image, and it is known as exotic range because the tree has been introduced either purposefully or accidentally to these areas from outside its native range. Now, coming to the uses of this tree, you know, the flowers of the tree are considered as a good source of pollen for honeybees in India. Now, honeybees are pollinating agents, and pollination process is necessary for many plants to grow fruit. If many plants are not properly pollinated, they cannot bear fruit or, you know, produce new seeds. Lack of pollination leads to fruitless tree, and from fruitless tree it can extend even up to food shortage. And this is the reason why many conservationists are into this conservation of honeybees. Next, it is commonly used as a fuel wood. See, the seed oil was formerly crucial as an illuminant in the lamps, but now it has been largely replaced by kerosene. Earlier it was used as a illuminant in lamps. The oil content of Pongamia seeds ranges from 35% to 40% of seed dry weight, and 55% of it is oleic acid. See, oleic acid is a ideal fatty acid for good quality biodiesel production. The Pongamia oil with a blend of diesel can be applied in automobiles without any further modification of engines. Next, it has some medicinal use. It is used for skin diseases, bronchitis, whooping cough, and also used to clean the teeth. More importantly, it is a preferred species for controlling soil erosion and binding sand dunes because of its extensive network of lateral roots. And because of its tolerance to moderate levels of salinity, it is ideal for recovering a variety of wastelands. And it is also used in reforestation of marginal lands. Now, marginal lands are those area that are found on the edge of cultivated areas. And in this marginal land, it is often, you know, difficult to grow crops. So even for reforesting this marginal lands, this particular Pongamia pinnata is used. We have displayed you a previously asked question in the preliminary examination in the year 2010. Has been provided for the benefit of the viewers. Now let us move on to the analysis of next news article. Now, in this article, we'll see the data related to GDP growth and imports. This article appears on page number 15 in Delhi edition and 13 in Chennai, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions. The analysis of this data will be helpful in prelims preparation under economic development and also in mains in GS paper 3 under Indian economy. So the news from this data is that India's economy appears to have slowed down slightly in the financial year 2018-19. Now, in Indian economy, there are three sectors. See, one is primary, secondary, then tertiary sector. Primary means agriculture sector. Secondary means the manufacturing sector or industry sector. And tertiary means services sector. This data tells that GVA or gross value addition in agriculture is slowing since the first quarter of financial year 2019. Always know that if it is mentioned as FY19 or fiscal 19, it refers to financial year 2018-19. Next, the article tells that the gross value addition or GVA in manufacturing or services sector remains flat line, which means there is no significant growth observed. Now, some reasons have been mentioned here for the slowdown. The first is that there is a declining growth in private consumption. Now, private consumption means people buying or purchasing things for their own consumption purposes. This declining growth in private consumption directly or indirectly means that the general public and the investors have started to save money in the form of, you know, bank savings or fixed investments, rather than spending for consumption purposes. It is mentioned that there is increase in the savings in the form of fixed investments. Now, the next reason given is the reduced exports. Now, it means that the manufacturing activity is dull in the economy. The data also notes that there is a fall in imports, which we'll discuss in a meanwhile. Now, let us see about GVA. Since GVA for all the three sectors of Indian economy have been mentioned in the news article. See, gross value addition at basic prices. In short, GVA at BP is the output minus the intermediate consumption. Here, the output means the input of materials and services plus the value addition. Let us see an illustration now to understand this GVA calculation better. Take a rice flour is manufactured. So it is a product of the manufacturing sector. And the output price is fixed at 50 rupees. But to manufacture this output, which is the rice flour, you need some basic inputs like rice and electricity. Rice is the main ingredient of rice flour here, and electricity is required to run the flour machine to turn the rice into rice flour. Now, if you see, rice is the output of the agriculture sector and electricity is the output of the services sector. So all these are intermediate consumption in order to manufacture this output, that is rice flour. Just to fix roughly price of rice at 20 rupees and the price of electricity as at 10 rupees. Now we know that the formula of GVA at basic prices is the output minus intermediate consumption. Here output is 50 rupees, intermediate consumption is 20 plus 10, which is 30 rupees. So the final GVA at basic prices is 50 minus 30, which is 20 rupees. So the value addition done here is for 20 rupees. Just know that the value addition is done by different factors of production such as man, machinery, etc. And one important thing to note here is the basic prices means it does not include taxes. Next, let us see the formula for GDP calculation. See, GDP at market prices is equal to the sum of the gross value added at basic prices plus those taxes minus the subsidies on the products. It means that the taxes on that particular product only is included and their subsidies are not included. Here the product taxes can include, you know, excise duty, import and export duties, and also the sales and service taxes. And the product subsidies include the subsidies on food, petroleum and fertilizer, also the interest subsidies given to the farmers and households through banks, like that. Note that GDP at market prices is simply referred as GDP. With these concepts in mind, now let us see the news article. In the first graph, they have mentioned that the annual GDP growth for financial year 2019 has been revised to 7%. Know that these estimates are released by Central Statistics Office that come under Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. And the agricultural sector's GVA growth in financial year 2019 is expected to be 2.7%. And next, see the implied real GDP growth in the fourth quarter of financial year 2019 was lower at 6.5%. Here, real GDP growth means the inflation is taken into consideration for the GDP growth. Always know that the reports related to economy will process and release data for 4 quarters in a financial year. So one financial year means 12 months. Financial year 2019-2020 is calculated from April this year to March next year. And the first quarter means first 3 months. The first month is April, then May, then June. And the second quarter means next 3 months, and so on. Now let's come back to the news article. See, in this graph, it is mentioned as second AE of financial year 2018-19 and first RE of financial year 2017-18 and second RE of financial year 2016-17. You just need to have some idea about this data shown on the graph. See, this is the calculation methodology that is used by Central Statistics Office to project the GDP growth. it is too technical in nature. For example, if you see here, the advanced estimates of financial year 2018-19 is benchmarked or compared with the first revised estimates of financial year 2017-18. And this data is again benchmarked or compared with the second revised estimates of financial year 2016-17. So all these nomenclature are too technical in nature, and you will not require this technical things for the exam. So just try to know the basic concepts like GDP and GVA for your exam preparation. Now, with respect to fall in imports, the article tells that the imports have slowed down in the last two quarters of financial year 2018-19. And this had signaled the slowdown in GDP growth. Here, the real import is calculated by dividing the nominal imports with headline WPI or wholesale price index, because the headline WPI will measure the prices of all the items of the economy and give a more realistic value. Note that here in the second graph, the growth rate of the real imports is given for the financial year 2017-18. Now let's come to the third graph. The third graph indicates that the consumers are spending lesser now. So when there is a slowdown in real GDP growth and imports, there is a reduction in private consumption expenditure. From this graph, you can see that the private consumption expenditure is almost flat in the last two quarters of financial year 2018-19. That means October, November, December, January, February and March. From October 2018 to March 2019. So when there is a reduction in private consumption, it is natural that people are not actively consuming the manufactured products in India. This manufactured product can be anything that a person uses, from clothes, food, automobiles, etc. Now come to the fourth graph. It says number of two-wheelers sold in India has reduced since February 2019 because the people are not purchasing or consuming this manufactured product. This graph also mentions that in April 2019, the passenger vehicle sales recorded the worst monthly fall when compared to the last 8 years. Now with this, we come to the end of this article. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the final session of practice come revision session. Now let us move on to the analysis of our next news article. Now the next article is about RISAT-2B mission of Indian Space Research Organization. The article has appeared on page 8 in Delhi edition and 6 in other editions taken up for analysis. Now the article will be relevant in prelims under current events of national importance and also in general science and in mains in GS paper 3 in science and technology developments and their applications and effects in everyday life, and also in achievements of Indians in science and technology, then in indigenization of technology and developing new technology. Now ISRO is going to launch radio imaging satellite 2B on May 22 from Sriharikota. See, this RISAT-2B is a radio imaging earth observation satellite. It has been developed by ISRO. It will be placed into orbit above around 550, more than 550 kilometers, to be very specific, 557 kilometers from Earth. It features an X-band synthetic aperture radar. A regular remote sensing or a regular optical imaging satellites cannot perceive hidden objects that are on the ground, particularly when it is cloudy or dark, because these regular satellites work like a light dependent camera. That is, they depend on light to sense these objects on the ground, whereas RISAT-2B satellite is equipped with an active sensor called as synthetic aperture radar, which can sense or observe Earth in a special way from space. That is, it can observe Earth day and night, even whether it is raining or whether it is cloudy, it can observe. And this feature is called as all-weather observing or seeing feature, that makes these satellites special and highly helpful for security forces and disaster relief agencies. Radar imaging satellites could sense these structures, new bunkers or camps, and sometimes even help to count the bunkers or number of camps, etc. Now, coming to the fields in which RISAT has applications, see, it is highly helpful in providing valuable information related to agriculture, forestry, and disaster management support, particularly with respect to floods and cyclone. Currently, India is using this radar imaging, particularly during the months of May to September, when it is of more rains and also more cloudy. So far, radar imaging data has been extensively used for forestry, soil, land use, geology, and also during floods and cyclone. Now, this RISAT will be launched, RISAT-2B will be launched by Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle, PSLV C-46. And PSLV C-46 is the 48th mission of PSLV, and it is the 14th flight of PSLV in core-alone configuration. See, when we mean core-alone configuration, there is no use of solid strap-on motors in the launch vehicle. And ISRO has so far orbited two radar imaging satellites, one that is RISAT-2 in the year 2009 and the other RISAT-1 in 2012. It is not RISAT-1 in 2009, it is RISAT-2 in 2009 and RISAT-1 in 2012. And ISRO had planned to deploy more, you know, around four or five RISAT satellites in the year 2019 itself. So it could be followed by, RISAT-2B could be followed by RISAT-2B-R1, 2B-R2, RISAT-1, capital A, 1B, 2A, and etc. So these series of RISAT satellites will add to the reconnaissance or surveying or observing capability, meaning the intelligence capability of India, from about 500 kilometer from Earth in space to have a comprehensive or complete vigil over the country. Now, the displayed prelims question will be discussed in the last session. Now let us move on to next news article. Now this article is about women who gave birth when they were just teenagers. The data point article appears on page number 9 in Chennai, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions and in page number 11 in Delhi edition. Now this article is relevant in prelims under economic and social development and in mains in GS paper 1 under women, developmental issues, problems and remedies and in GS 2 in issues relating to health. Now the article is based on information from a study conducted by International Food Policy Research Institute and based on National Family Health Survey of 2015-16. The article states that teenage pregnant girls, you know, get relatively poor maternal health care, both antenatal care and postnatal care. In general terms, antenatal care is referring to before birth care, as the word anti means before and natal means birth, and postnatal is after birth care. Antenatal care covers the care and help received by pregnant women from health professionals during the course of their pregnancy before the birth of child. Postnatal care is the health care of a mother after the birth of a child, and particularly for around at least 6 to 8 weeks after the birth of the baby. The article also states that children of teenage mothers are relatively more stunted than the children of those women who gave birth after their teenage. Now, child stunting refers to children before the age of 5 who have low height for their corresponding age. Now, child stunting is the reflection of poor nutrition, or in technical terms, according to Global Hunger Index reports, it's a reflection of chronic undernutrition, that is everyday undernutrition. Also, the data point compares the anemic status of teenage mothers with older mothers. It says that the teenage mothers are more anemic than the older mothers, that is, relatively more teenage mothers suffer from anemia. Now, this anemia is a medical condition of having red blood cells less than the normal required number of RBC, or having hemoglobin content less than the normal quantity of hemoglobin in the blood. Now this is serious because the oxygen carrying capacity of the blood is lesser for a person suffering from anemia. The study also found that the teenage mothers are also exposed to relatively poor sanitation facilities, and also institutional deliveries are also relatively low. Institutional deliveries refer to facilities like hospitals, you know, trained healthcare professionals for women for giving birth to child. The National Family Health Survey of 2015-16 has found out that the eastern and northeastern states have relatively higher percentage of mothers who had their first childbirth in their teenage itself. And during the conduct of NFHS survey, that is 2015-16, it is found that more than 18% of teenage girls in the states of West Bengal and Tripura were pregnant. The article is important as one have to imagine what health effects a child could have as a result of the teenage pregnancy and the what effects there will be on the mother. This also refers to poor state of information delivery, sanitation facilities, maternal health care, and poor information delivery on reproductive health to girl children. And there are many interrelated issues with respect to this, such as early marriage, child marriage, etc. The displayed prelims question will be discussed in the last session. Now let us move on to next news article. Now the next news article discusses about electronically transmitted postal ballot system. Now this article has appeared on page 12 in Delhi edition and page number 10 in Chennai, Bengaluru, Thiruvananthapuram editions. Now this article is relevant in prelims under Indian Polity and Governance and in GS paper 2 under important aspects of e-governance. Also it can be linked to salient features of Representation of People Act. And the news article is about postal ballot counting. See, before analyzing the news, let us first understand the background by knowing important facts about electronically transmitted postal ballot system and who is a service voter. Now, this electronically transmitted postal ballot system is a system that enables the voters to cast their vote using an electronically received postal ballot from anywhere outside their constituency. So the voters who makes this choice is extended right now, particularly for service voters only. The service voters, we'll see who are service voters. For this purpose, there is a registration process first. One has to register as a service voter online. Then when elections are announced, the returning officer of the native constituency of the service voter will send the postal ballot electronically to the unit officer, and the postal ballot that is sent electronically will also be having filled in details of the service voter. Now, e-postal ballot pin will also be sent to the service voter or his unit officer to open this electronically transmitted postal ballot. The electronic postal ballot has to be printed, and also the other forms such as declarations, etc. And in the electronic postal ballot that is printed, now the service voter has to make a mark for a particular candidate for whom he is intended to cast his vote and sign the required form such as declaration, etc. And also to get the attestation on the declaration, and then send it to the returning officer, and with this the process is complete. Now this system is implemented in line with the existing postal ballot system. Postal ballot will be transmitted through electronically transmitted postal ballot system, we saw that the postal ballot will be transmitted through electronic means to the service voters. Now it enables the service voters to cast their vote on an electronically received postal ballot from their preferred location, which is outside their originally assigned voting constituency. This system would be an easier option for facilitating voting, particularly for the service voters. And this has removed the increased time constraint for the dispatch of postal ballot to the service voters. Now this electronically transmitted postal ballot system is developed by Election Commission of India with the help of Center for Development of Advanced Computing, shortly called as CDAC. See, it is a fully secured system and it has two layers of security. Secrecy in this type of postal ballot is maintained by the use of one-time password and PIN, that is personal identification number. Every e-ballot has a unique QR code, so duplication of the vote casted through this electronically transmitted postal ballot is not possible due to this unique QR code. Now, this QR code stands for Quick Response Code. It is a barcode that can be scanned and can direct a user to a website or to carry out a specific action. Practically, these QR codes are a means for marketers to bridge the gap between physical and digital worlds. Now, the class of electors who are eligible for this electronically transmitted postal ballot system is the service voters. Now, the Election Commission of India says there are service voters and classified service voters. It says that service voters will be eligible for this electronically transmitted postal ballot system, whereas classified service voters will be allowed to use the proxy voting system. But even several government documents say that service voters are also eligible for this proxy voting system. Now, classified service voters are those who opt for proxy voting. Here, note that service voters are those who are serving in the armed forces of the Union and those who are serving in a force to which Army Act of 1950 applies, for such as forces of Assam Rifles, Central Reserve Police Force, Border Security Force, Indo-Tibetan Border Police, SSB, National Securities Guard, Border Road Organization, Center Industrial Security Force, etc. And those employed in a post outside India under the Government of India. For example, ambassadors of India. And then member of an armed police force of a particular state, but serving outside that state. Now, these members are called as service voters. Also, the wife of a service voter who ordinarily resides with the service voter is an ordinary resident under the subsection 6 of section 20 of Representation of People Act 1950. Note that this act is Representation of People Act 1950. There is also Representation of People Act 1951. That is why the GS2 syllabus of Union Public Service Commission for Civil Service Examination just mentions the salient features of Representation of People Act without mentioning the year, because there are two legislations. Therefore, the provision of eligibility for electronically transmitted postal ballot system is also extended to the wife of a service voter. Now, note that if the service voter is a woman, the husband of a lady service voter is not eligible to use this service under the provisions given by the Election Commission. Now, the purpose of the online system is to create convenient and easy to use online system for defense personnel to become service voters. So, this electronically transmitted postal ballot system enables easy, efficient and hassle-free postal ballot. So, now coming to the news article, the article states that the Election Commission has issued directions to the chief electoral officers that the electronic voting machines and postal ballot counting should be done simultaneously. Once the electronic voting machine counting is completed, then the VVPAT slips counting shall start. The Election Commission has told that the number of postal ballot papers and for counting has gone up considerably. This is because of the introduction of electronically transmitted postal ballot system and casting of postal ballot by election duty staff at the facilitation centers. And see, the electronically transmitted postal ballot system contains a QR code. So there is requirement of mandatory QR code reading for the e-postal ballot system. Hence, this will increase the time of counting of the postal ballots. The article also states that the Election Commission has clarified that wherever the margin of victory is less than the number of rejected postal ballot papers, which was declared as invalid at the time of counting, then all the rejected postal ballot papers will be mandatorily re-verified by the returning officer before the declaration of the result. And such re-verification will also have to be videographed. With this, we come to the end of our news analysis. With this, now let's move on to the final session, that is the practice prelims questions discussion. The first question, GDP at market prices is. See, GDP at market prices is nothing but GVA at basic prices plus product taxes minus product subsidies. So here option C is the correct answer. So the product taxes can include your excise duty, import export duties, sales and service taxes. And product subsidies include subsidies on food, petroleum, fertilizer, interest subsidies given to farmers through banks. Now the second question is with respect to RISAT 2B. They have given three statements and are asking which of the statements are correct. See, here in the statements, you first see the options, and if you can eliminate any one statement, you can easily arrive at the answer. But you have to eliminate perfectly incorrect statement to make this method work. See, like for example, let us consider you are eliminating statement 1, then you can get only one option without statement 1, that is option B. So you may not know some certain fact given in the other statements and you can arrive at the answer. Now for this question, the first statement is correct. So they are saying it is a radar imaging earth observation satellite developed by ISRO. Now this statement is correct, RI, radar imaging. The second statement states that this RISAT-2B will be launched by geosynchronous satellite launch vehicle. Now this statement is wrong. We know it will be launched by PSLV C-46, that is on the Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle. So one important thing about RISAT-2B is after a period of some 7 years, now they are launching this RISAT-2B. Okay, so the third statement, it increases the reconnaissance capability of India. Now we know this statement is correct. Anyhow, let's see how we can work out by eliminating the second statement. Now, if you can eliminate the second statement, then option A becomes incorrect, option B becomes incorrect, option D becomes incorrect. So this makes option C, 1 and 3 as correct. So even if you don't know some fact mentioned in the statements, you can easily attempt such questions, but you have to eliminate the incorrect statement. So option C is correct, it increases, option C is correct, and the statement 3 is also correct, it increases the reconnaissance capability of India. Reconnaissance refer to surveying, observation, like that. Now the next question is with respect to child stunting. Which of the following best describes the term child stunting frequently seen in the news? Now the first statement, condition where children under the age of 5 having low height for their weight, appears to be correct because low height. The condition where children under the second statement, the condition under children under the age of 5 having low weight for their height. Now low weight for height is what is called as child wasting. Okay, so option B is wrong. The third statement, the condition where children under the age of 5 having low height for their corresponding age. Now this statement is correct and option C is the correct answer on the right description for child stunting. Now the next question is with respect to electronically transmitted postal ballot system. They were given two statements and are asking which of the statements are correct. First statement, it is a system that enables the entitled voters to cast their vote using an electronically received postal ballot from anywhere outside their constituency. Now we know that this system enables entitled voters. In our context, in the present day scenario, entitled voters are service voters, and this statement is correct. The second statement, the wife of a service voter who ordinarily resides with him is eligible for voting under this method, and this statement is correct because a wife of a service voter becomes an ordinary resident with the service voter under section 20 subsection 6 of Representation of People Act 1950. So statement 2 is also correct. So according to the present day scenario, wife of a service voter is also eligible to vote under this electronically transmitted postal ballot system. But note that for now, the husband of a lady service voter is not eligible to use this service under the act. Now therefore the answer, correct answer for this question is option C, both 1 and 2. A practice mains question under GS3. Explain the linkages between Islamic State and other extremist groups and youth in the South Asian region. What countermeasures should be taken to prevent the same and their actions in Indian soil? Now you state the linkages between Islamic State and local extremist organizations in various countries in the South Asian region. One, see, the representatives from IS could come to the region. Two, the people could who once migrated to support this Islamic State are now returning, and they may continue their agenda here. And three, through internet and social media, innumerable children and youth could be radicalized and could be used as lone wolves, and also utilize them to carry out coordinated attacks as carried out recently in Sri Lanka. Now, when giving countermeasures, you give equal weightage to how to counter these linkages and how to counter their actions. In these measures, you could utilize the points discussed under the Lessons for India in the today's editorial article analysis. The necessity to recognize the threat of Islamic State 2.0 and taking adequate counter program and using investigations of National Investigation Agency as a tool to identify the linkages that exist region-wise and directly with Islamic State, and, you know, containing or safeguarding the children and Islamic youth from and other youths from radicalization, specifically through, you know, internet and social media and other modes as well. With this, you can use these points for answer writing in this mains question. With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, press the like button, share, comment, and subscribe to our Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for daily notifications for The Hindu News Analysis.